The Aldwych Theatre, London. Tonight, the persecution and assassination of Marat as performed by the inmates of the Asylum of Charenton under the direction of the Marquis de Sade. And all tickets are sold.
When you look at all these people coming into the theatre, it's much the same crowd as is coming into any London theatre. Solid, middle class, students. The staple diet of the theatre, the people that keep the place going. At the Aldwych, they've become uneasy about this audience, not that they don't like them, they like them very much. But shouldn't they be reaching out to persuade a very much wider public that this is the place for them, and the plays are for them too?
All right, reach out. But how? And what's the result? It's a story that tells itself, really, and here are the ingredients. Take an area like Paddington, 3 stops on the Underground from the West End, but full of people who normally wouldn't dream of going to the Aldwych. Take 6 actors from the Royal Shakespeare Company. Persuade them to work even longer hours than their normal stint. Make a travelling team of them. Take a director, Michael Cousteau, who passionately believes that the theatre's true foundation is ordinary people. Let him put a show together and take it out to the audience. Make a tour of Paddington and talk to people who might go to the theatre but don't. Take the managing director of the Royal Shakespeare Company, a man who could well afford to sit back and rest on his reputation, but who doesn't feel like that, and now mix these ingredients together, and what happens? Let's start with Peter Hall at Stratford-on-Avon.
We're uneasy about not the numbers that are coming, but who those numbers are drawn from. I would say, on the one hand, there's a small minority of kind of theatre-goers who go to the theatre, and that's a very tiny percentage. Then, blessedly, we have an enormous number of young people who have just left school or just come out of university. But they're all kind of the intellectual kind, or they've had some intellectual training. I believe, generally, that standards of appreciation are going up, and we find that people have an appreciation who didn't know they'd have it.
Now, what's the best way to get them in, do you think?
I think the best way to get them in is to go out and get them.
Well, what happens when they go out and get them? This is the Rutherford School, Paddington. The audience comes from the houses, flats and tenements that surround it. 400 people are coming, and many of them have never been inside a theatre or heard an actor live.
"500 years before the birth of Christ, I came out of the clash of joy and sorrow, fertility and death. I came out of the turning of the seasons, men singing and dancing together in a circle. I entered an actor."
One is naturally shy and worried about a situation like this. There's something a bit condescending about the idea of taking theatre to the masses. And it's not entirely aimed at that, this programme. But I think there are such cultural barriers in our age that the very word theatre, as a minority art, frightens a lot of people to death. We find the words Royal Shakespeare Company terrify people.
One of the reasons I think that people don't go to the theatre is because when a bloke has done a hard day's work, and most people do, by the time they come home, and the thoughts of getting ready to go to the theatre, and perhaps go down there and pay, what, 25 or 30 bob for a seat, it's a bit much to ask, I would say.
Well, I think the modern generation, I don't think actually they're more interested in it. Unless Shakespeare could be put on as a sort of musical or something like that.
The people that are going, they're regular theatre goers. They drift around in a different circle to what I do. I feel out of place in the theatre.
When they come home, all they do is have a bit of a wash. Perhaps it's so convenient to switch on the television, that's what they do. And I think that's one of the troubles with working class people. They take everything which is easy. And who can blame them, after all?
"But even as he makes, whatever he makes, and no matter how much he makes, man longs to destroy the thing he has made. Finding no enemy, he becomes his own enemy. As he traps the horse, so he traps other men. But the others strike back, trap closing on trap. Having eaten enough, Man must build a wall around whatever food is left, and other men must pull down that wall so the roof gets split. And the rain, the changing air, wash away whatever is left of man and his cities when men have done with them.
Good. That's much better that time. You've got the verbs and the, you know, and the separate ideas much clearer. I think what if we can get back into it now is your original thing of the kind of character you're playing as opposed to the one that David's playing. Yeah. You know, a dual inset, if you like. You know, proper thing, especially after Monty's Country.
Now tell me, what is it you're trying to do?
What we're trying to do is to break out of a circle in which the theatre is imprisoned. Now, our theatre, as you know, is rooted in Shakespeare. And we believe from the text and from what we know of the world of Shakespeare that in his time the theatre spoke not just to a small group, a culture group, but to everyone, to the butcher and the baker, as well as the nobleman, the courtier and the poet. And we think that a theatre that can do that is the only kind of theatre that really counts. And therefore, what we're trying to do in this whole thing, this whole enterprise of travelling around London and playing in all sorts of odd places, is to reach the particular class of people that is conspicuous by its absence from the theatre.
All human life is here. Now, this could be the motto for this smash hit of the 1550s. What about this for a build-up?
The inevitable and true tragedy of Mr. Arden of Feversham in Kent, who was most wickedly murdered by the means of his disloyal and wanton wife, who, for the love she bare to one Mosby, hired two desperate ruffians, Black Will and Shakebag, to kill him.
What? 20 guineas? Give my fella George Shakebag and me 20 guineas, and if they'll have thine own father slain that thou mayest inherit his land, we'll kill him.
Aye, thy mother, thy brother, thy sister, all thy kin.
Well, this is it. Arden of Feversham hath highly wronged me over divers matters, that no revenge but death will serve the turn. Will you two kill him? Here's guineas down.
Give me the money and I'll stab him as he stands pissing against the wall.
Where is he?
He's now in London at Aldersgate Street.
He's as dead as if he had been condemned by Act of Parliament if once Black Will and I swear his death.
In this turbulent tempest of sex and passion, love's true course can scarce run smooth. Thrill to the fate of these two damned creatures.
Alice!
I pay thee, Mosby, let our springtime wither. Our harvest else will yield but loathsome weeds. Forget, I pray you, what has passed between us, for now I blush and tremble at the thought.
What, are you changed?
Aye, to my former happy state again. From title of an odious strumpet's name to honest Arden's wife. Not Arden's honest wife. Even my forehead is thy name engraven. That mean artificer, that low-born name.
Nay, if you can curse, let me breathe curses forth. I left the marriage of an honest maid whose dowry would have weighed down all thy wealth. But now the rain hath beaten off thy guilt. Thy worthless copper shows thee counterfeit. Go, get thee gone. A coat's made for thy hinds. I'm too good to be thy favourite.
Nay, Mosby, hear me speak a word or two. Or I'll bite my tongue if it speak bitterly. Look on me, Mosby, or I'll kill myself. Sweet Mosby is as gentle as a king, and I too blind to judge him otherwise. Flowers do sometimes grow in fallow lands, weeds in gardens, roses grow on thorns. So whatsoe'er my Mosby's father was, himself is valued gentle for his worth.
Oh, how you women can insinuate and clear a trespass with your sweet set tongue. I'll forget this quarrel, gentle Alice, provided I be tempted so no more.
Then with thy lips seal up this new-made match.
Hark! Somebody comes.
Shudder at the dreadful murder which unties this tangled knot of greed and passion.
Mosby! Alice! What will you do?
Nothing!
Nothing but take you up, sir, nothing else.
Here's for the pressing iron you told me of.
And here's for the £10 in my sleeve.
What? Groans thou? Give me the weapon. Take this for hindering Mosby's love of mine.
The most suspenseful drama ever staged.
Mistress, the guests are at the door open. They knock. What shall I let them in?
Mosby, go thou and keep them company. Susan, fetch water and wash away this blood.
Oh, mistress. Oh, mistress. The blood cleaveth to the ground and will not out.
But with my nails I'll scrape away the blood. Well, the more I strive, the more the blood appears.
Well, what's the reason, mistress, can you tell?
Because I blush not at my husband's death.
You chew your fingers to the toenails.
Oh, mistress. Mistress, the mayor and the watch are coming towards our house with gloves and swords.
Let the door fast. Let them not come in.
Yes.
Quick, convey the body to the field. Hark! They knock! Now, Susan, let them in. How now, Master Mayor? Have you brought my husband home?
Arden, thy husband and my friend, is slain.
Oh! By whom, Master Mayor, can you tell?
Nay, I know not, but behind the abbey there he lies murdered in most piteous case.
But, Master Mayor, are you sure it is he?
I am too sure. Would God were otherwise.
Find out the murderers, let them be known.
Aye, so we shall. Come you along with us.
Wherefore?
Know you this hand towel and this knife?
It is the pig's blood that we had to supper. Wherefore stay you? Find the murderers out.
I fear me you'll prove one of them yourself.
Aye, one of them? What mean these questions?
I fear me he was murdered in this house and carried to the fields forward. From that place, backwards and forwards, may you see the print of many footsteps in the snow. Look round this chamber where we are and you shall find part of his guiltless blood. Look, in the chair where he was wont to sit. See, his blood. It is too manifest.
It is a cup of wine that Susan shed.
Aye, truly.
It is his blood which trumpet thou hast shed. And if I live, thou and thy accomplices, which have contrived and wrought his death, shall rue it. Tremble to the terrible retribution of these wicked lovers. See them glory in their naked sexual passion. You will never forget the searing story of Arden of Faversham. All next week with full supporting programme. Boy!
I thoroughly enjoyed it. I could have gone on watching it, and when the lights went out, that was it.
Yeah, but the thing about it, Joyce, I mean, we got some dirty little bits in it, which we all liked.
But it wasn't all dirty.
Ah, no.
Now, if you're going to get people of a non-intellectual kind, with however many quotes around it,
yes.
Do you think you're going to get them in to the same sort of plays that you put on normally?
Yes, absolutely. I don't believe you should lower your standards. Our experience is we do Beckett, we do Brecht, we do Pinter, and it's only because people think that they are something highbrow that they don't come. Our experience is that a group of people from a factory coming to see a play of Henry Living's had a jolly good laugh, and people coming to see a play of Brecht said, oh, we didn't know it had a good story. I mean, it's this whole mystique of the theatre, which is something this very class-conscious society of ours has set up.
The theatre, I think they're a bit too toffee-nosed for me now. For a coat affair.
Some people regard the working class in a very strange light, consider that bread, beer and skittles is sufficient.
The plays are being put on now are a lot of rubbish, a lot of stuff, a lot of stuff that the ordinary working man doesn't understand. The plays are far too short. You get an hour and three quarters play, but you're in the theatre for 2 hours and a half.
I'm doing it for several reasons. I suppose partly because I've got a nostalgia for this this idea of a theatre that speaks to the whole of a society or to as wide a group as one can think of. And partly because, I suppose, just instinctively, one feels there's something wrong, there's something missing, there's, you know, it's just not enough what we're doing, and it seems the important thing to be done.
I think
Crab, my dog, be the sourest natured dog that lives. I was sent to deliver him as a present to Mistress Sylvia from my master. And I comes no sooner into the dining chamber, but he steps me to a trencher and steals a chicken's leg. Oh, it is a foul thing when a cur cannot keep himself in all companies. You shall judge. He thrusts me himself into the company of three or four gentlemanlike dogs under the Duke's table. He hadn't been there, bless the mark, a pissing while, but all the chamber smelt him. What dog is that, says one.
Whip him out, says another.
Hang him up, says the Duke. Now, I, having been acquainted with the smell before, knew it was Crab, and goes me to the fella that whips the dogs. Friend, quoth I, you mean to whip the dogs? Aye, marry do I, quoth he. You doing them all wrong, quoth I. 'Twas I did the thing you wot of. He makes no more ado than he whips me out of the chamber. How many masters will do that for his servant? Nay, I'll be sworn I sat in the stocks for puddings he hath stolen. Otherwise he'd have been executed. I've stood in the pillory for geese he hath killed. Otherwise he'd have been hanged for it. Thou thinks not of this now. Nay, I remember the trick you served me when I took me leave of Madam Sylvia. Did I not bid thee mark me and do as I do? When did thou see me heave up my leg and make water against a gentlewoman's stockings? Did thou ever see me do such a trick?
Well, if you haven't recognised it, that was from Two Gentlemen of Verona, a first play by a young playwright called William Shakespeare. Now, please, don't panic, which has already shown you. It can be quite famous.
When everyone said to me, would you like to go and see Shakespeare, I naturally thought of Macbeth and the heavy, heavy stuff. Not for me, thank you very much.
But that type of thing I saw
was very good.
Do you really see, in your mind's eye, an ordinary greater public audience for Shakespeare?
Well, I think there is now. I mean, in television terms, maybe the total audience that we play to in both theatres of 750,000 people is not very many if you compare it with an evening's television viewing. But it's pretty enormous, and they're fighting to get in. And I believe there is a popular strength in the works of Shakespeare and in many of our modern dramatists which needs using.
This day is called the Feast of Crispian. He that outlives this day and comes safe home will stand a tiptoe when this day is named and rouse him at the name of Crispian. He that shall live this day and see old age will yearly on the vigil feast his neighbors and say, tomorrow is St. Crispian. Then will he strip his sleeve and show his scars and say, these wounds I had on Crispin's day. Old men forget, yet all shall be forgot, but he'll remember with advantages what feats he did that day. Then shall our names, familiar in his mouth as household words, Harry the King, Bedford and Exeter, Warwick and Talbot, Salisbury and Gloucester, be in their flowing cups freshly remembered. This story shall a good man teach his son, and Crispin Crispian shall ne'er go by from this day to the ending of the world. But we in it shall be remembered.
The only piece I didn't like was the speech from Henry V. I didn't understand it, so I didn't like it.
Oh, well, it does take a lot of understanding.
I think if I'd seen the rest of it, I would have enjoyed it. But Just seeing that little piece out of it, I didn't like it. But I enjoyed the rest.
Yeah, well, I expected
it. But I think it was the actors,
we didn't understand
though.
It. In fact, we don't go often enough. That's it's going to be like that. I'd like to go more often. Mm.
I think it's like classical music, you have to be taught it to appreciate it. And if you're not taught it, well then, all Shakespeare's like that.
I don't think you can argue people into going to the theatre. I don't think you can talk, can say it's good for you or you'll enjoy it or it'll open new horizons, even if these things are true. I think the only way you can do it is to show it to them and say, here it is, to put it in their path. And that's why this whole exercise has taken the form of a show that is placed in front of people.
Ah, that's the thing. Would you go down the West End to it?
Yeah. If it wasn't too expensive, that's another thing.
That's another thing, isn't it?
I wouldn't go and pay 30 shillings to see it. Oh, no, I think it's
time. All this is aimed finally at our new theatre in the Barbican, which is going to have 1,500 seats, and I hope enough cheap seats for people to make a regular habit of dropping in.
And it should be called Bottom's Dream, because it hath no bottom.
Shakespeare was an actor as well as a playwright, and by using a speech in Hamlet to a group of travelling players not unlike ourselves, he's able to give actors a few pertinent words of advice, in no way different to the sort of notes we get from our director after every performance. And it always goes something like this.
Speak the speech, I pray you, as I pronounced it to you, trippingly on the tongue. But if you mouth it, as many of your players do, I had us leave the town, crier spoke my lines. Nor do not saw the air too much with your hand thus, but use all gently. Oh, it offends me to the soul to hear a robustious, periwigged, pated fellow tear a passion to tatters, to very rags, to split the ears of the groundlings, who for the most part are capable of nothing but inexplicable dumb shows at noise. Now be not too tame, neither, but let your own discretion be your tutor. And let those that play your clowns speak no more than is set down for them. That's villainous, and shows a most pitiful ambition in the fool that uses it. Suit the word to the action, and the action to the word, with this special observance, that you o'erstep not the modesty of nature. For anything so overdone is from the purpose of playing, whose end, both at the first and now, was and is to hold, as 'twere, the mirror up to nature, to show virtue her own feature, scorn her own image, and the very age and body of the time his form and pressure.
Well, do you find all these audiences have been about the same, or very different?
No, very different. You see, they're different audiences from the theatre audiences we get anyway. But within that context, they're all very different each time. Every time we turn up somewhere, we've no idea what sort of audience they're going to be. I mean, they may never have been to a theatre at all, some of them. Some of them may be quite interested in theatres. Some of them might be very young, when we go to a youth club, for instance, 16, 17. It's other places than people older than me, if you can believe it.
Did you find that they some of them are very good audiences and some of them very bad audiences, or are they much of a level on that?
No, they change enormously. Sometimes they're very good and sometimes... But our job, you see, is to get hold of them when we start, because they don't know what they're coming to see. And I think they think it's going to be something terribly arty, and they come with a certain reverence. Oh dear, it's Shakespeare, that sort of thing. We have to get hold of them immediately and break them down.
What the audiences have seen and what has delighted them and surprised them is, in fact, that they've seen an actor acting at close quarters. This hasn't detracted at all from what the actor's doing, not one iota. In actual fact, it's heightened it. And one hasn't lost any of the magic of acting at all. Mm. But they've seen it at close quarters, and they like it even more.
I mean, in fact, I think the audience for good theatre in this country as a whole has grown in the last 10 years. I think our whole society is revaluing its standards and our nation is revaluing its position in the world, and this has thrown up a lot of new writers and a ferment of creative activity in all the arts. We are, God save the mark, suddenly an artistic nation.
Lovely, I like the theatre, I like opera.
Well, variety mostly.
No, I'm afraid when I was school I went to, they wasn't very hot on Shakespeare.
Oh, I like to see all nice love stories.
They tell me that in Shakespeare's day, all the female parts were played by men. Yeah. I suppose the acting profession's been a queer old lot ever since.
But you know, of course, that the theatre's always had its enemies, and the Puritans were attacking the Elizabethan stage even before Shakespeare came along. Let's listen to a few theatre haters.
Play is like a sink in the town whereunto all the filth doth run.
Or like a bile in the body that draweth all the ill humour unto it.
The Lord of his mercy open the eyes of the magistrates to pluck down these places of abuse.
This prayer was answered. In 1642, Cromwell issued this proclamation.
It is thought fit and ordained by the Lords and Commons in this Parliament assembled, that whereas these sad times and these set causes of humiliation do continue, public stage plays shall cease and be forborne.
So the theatres were closed, actors lost their jobs, and 6 years later, Charles I lost his head. And when the theatre was restored, together with Charles II, it was a very different place from the bustling Elizabethan playhouses. You see, before we used to play to the butcher and the baker, as well as the courtier and the nobleman. But now we became the playthings of the aristocracy, and we gave them brittle sex comedies, which were copied from the plays that were shown in France. Just let's take a quick look at France for a minute, because about this same time, there was a new comic genius there called Jean-Baptiste Molière. Now, Molière, like Shakespeare, had been an actor as well as a playwright, and he loved the tumblers and jugglers and the strolling players who came to France from Italy. So here's a scene from one of his comedies in which Gérant, an old man, has played a very nasty trick on his servant, who's called Scapin. So the servant decides to get his own back on him. Enter Scapin.
Oh, sir! Oh, my lord! Look out! Hide, escape! They're looking for you everywhere. They're going to kill you.
Me?
Yes, a great big angry gang shouting murder, murder.
Scapin, what am I to do?
Oh, I don't know, sir. What a dreadful situation. I'm terribly worried about you. Wait! Stop there! No, it's nothing, sir.
Well, Scapin, can't you think up some way of getting me out of this?
Yes, I can think of one thing, sir.
Yes?
Only I'd run the risk of getting killed myself.
Oh, Scapin, show yourself a faithful servant. Don't desert me, I beg you.
I'll do what I can, sir. I'm too fond of you to leave you here defenseless.
You shall have this suit of clothes when I've worn it a bit longer.
Oh, look! The very thing to say to you must hide inside this sack.
No,
no, it's nothing, sir. You must hide inside this sack and keep as quiet as a mouse. I'll carry you on my back like a sack of potatoes, past your enemies and safe home.
It's a marvellous idea.
I'll get my own back on him now. Keep writing, sir. Take care not to show yourself. And don't stir whatever happens.
Oh, don't you worry about me.
Oh, sorry, sir. Somebody coming now, sir. Hide.
I want to kill Geronta.
Don't move, sir.
You man with the sack.
Yes, sir.
I will give you £1 if you tell me where Geronta is.
What do you want him for, sir?
I want to kill him.
Oh, you can't do that to a gentleman like Mr. Geront.
What? That fool, that rascal, that scoundrel?
Mr. Geront is not a fool, or a rascal, or a scoundrel.
Are you a friend of his?
I certainly am, sir.
Well then, you take this for him then.
Ow! 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 Oh, help! I'm being assaulted! Ow! Ooh!
Auf Wiedersehen!
Come back here! Come back here!
I can't bear any more of this!
Oh, I'm beaten black and blue, sir. My shoulders are all raw.
Yes, but it was my shoulders he was beating.
Yes, but you only got the thin end of the stick, sir.
Skipper, why didn't you move away?
Look out! There's another one coming, sir. Looks like a foreigner to me, sir.
What is moving in that sack there?
It's just potatoes, sir.
I will put my spear through that sack there.
But take it easy, sir.
Will you tell me what is in that sack?
Never.
Never?
Never.
Well then, you take this for him then.
Ow, oh, ow, help, ow, ooh, ah. Come back here, you terrible-looking
traitor. I'm nearly beaten to death.
I'm dead already, sir.
Yes, but why should he
be? Look out! All over the place, sir. Surrounded.
We gotta find Geront.
We must search everywhere.
Over there.
No, no, here. Hide, sir, you're surrounded.
Ha-ha, this is the servant. Where's your master, you rascal?
Oh, don't hurt me, you ugly-looking lot of foreigners. Speak up, quick! Oh, take it easy, masters. If you don't tell us where your master is, we'll beat you till you're black and blue. I don't care what you do to me. I'll never give my master away.
Oh, so you want to get beaten up, do you?
I don't care what you do to me. I'll never give my master away.
Right then, here it comes.
Now, if you're going to get a mass audience into the theatre, you'll have to reckon with this, that they've all been subjected to years and years of television. Are they on a very wet night, for instance, going to take the trouble to go to the theatre? Are you fighting a losing battle?
I think we would be if the experience was the same, but what they see when they've turned on their switch and what they do when they've tramped through the rain and come into the theatre, what they see there is something quite different. In that sense, the theatre is not archaic. It is a living thing in which the actual dialogue between what's on the stage and in the audience happens now, at this moment, in this building, this night only. It's very personal. Something quite different. It's passive watching television.
It's this television that's broke the home up, it's conversation up between husband and wife now. I mean, you walk home in the home in the evening there, and the first thing you do, right, you get your dinner, crash onto the television.
Who wants to go out?
I mean, you sit there and watch television, what happens? You don't talk to nobody, anything like that. You don't even talk to a wife, she starts to speak. You say, shut up, we're listening to that. And that's exactly how it goes on.
So we jump over 200 years, we leave France, come back to England at the middle of the 19th century. And there's a great boom in the theatre. They weren't interested in poetry, form, and the great questions of life. They were too tired. They wanted entertainment and relief and escape. So we gave it to them. We gave them pathos, suspense and spectacle. And the new poet of the theatre was no longer the actor or the playwright, but the technician.
Oh, where's he going?
It's the age, as you see, of the stagehand.
He's good, isn't he?
Thank you.
He's
very
good. Oh, lovely.
Thank you. Well, these two tapes are supposed to represent train lines. But of course, in the Pavilion Theatre, Whitechapel, in 1865, they had real railway lines, and they built a real railway station. And they even had a real railway train. All the things, in fact, that nowadays we go to the cinema to see. But this is how they did it in 1865 in the Pavilion Theatre. The train scene from Under the Gaslight.
Oh, it is impossible for me to go farther. This is the second time I've run away from home and friends. But now they shall never find me. Oh, the trains must have all passed. And there are no conveyances till tomorrow.
Beg your pardon, ma'am. Are you looking for somebody?
Oh, thank you, no. Are you the man in charge of this station?
Yes, ma'am.
When is the next train to York?
York? Oh, not all morning. We've only one more train through here tonight. That's the down one. It'll be here in about 20 minutes. Express train.
What is this place here?
That? Oh, that's the signal station shed. It serves for storeroom, baggage room, everything.
May I stay there tonight?
There? Well, it's an odd place, and I should hardly think you'd like it.
You shall have this if you let me remain here.
Oh, well, I've looked up a good many things there in my time, but I've never had a young lady for freight before. No, though, rules is rules.
Oh, you refuse me. Well, I shall only have to remain here all night.
Here?
Yes.
In the open air?
Yes.
Why, it will kill you.
Oh, so much the better.
Oh, pardon me for questions, ma'am, but, well, you're a running away from somebody, ain't you?
Oh, yes, I am.
Well, tell me this, then. It ain't the old man or the old man's home you're running away from, young lady.
No, you good, honest fellow, no. I have no father.
Oh, then by Jerusalem, I'll do for you what I can. Anything but run away from them that have not their interests, but yours at heart. Come, you may stay there. But I'll have to lock you in.
Oh, I desire that you should.
You won't mind the baggage. There's old shovels, mowing machines, and what's that?
Axes.
Axes?
Oh, are a bundle of axes.
Lock me in safely, won't you?
I'll be sure I will. There, safe as a jail. 10 minutes and down she comes. It's all safe this way, me noisy beauty. And you may come as soon as you like. Good night, miss.
Good night.
Oh. 10 minutes before the train comes. I'll wait here for it.
Hello.
I say, the train won't stop here too long, will it?
Too long? It won't stop here at all.
Well, I must reach the shore tonight. There'll be murder done unless I can prevent it.
Murder or no murder, the train can't be stopped.
That's a lie. By waving the red signal for danger, the engineer must stop, I tell you.
You think I'm a fool? What, disobey orders and lose my job? Then what's to become of my wife and children in Paddington?
I won't be fooled. I will confiscate some farmer's horse about here and get there before them somehow. Then, when Bike arrives on his donkey cart, he'll be ready to sit for a picture of surprise.
Will he?
Bike?
Yes, Bike! Where's that pistol of yours?
In my breast pocket.
Just what I needed.
You ain't gonna shoot me?
No.
Well, I'm obliged to you for that.
Just sit down, will you?
What for? Yes. Well, I don't mind if I do take a seat. Hello, what's this?
You'll see. You'll see.
Bike, what are you going to do?
I'm going to put you to bed.
Bike, you don't mean to... My God, you're a villain.
I'm going to put you to bed. You won't toss much. In 10 minutes, you'll be sound asleep. So... you'd get down to Virginia Water before me, would you?
No!
You'd dog me and play the eavesdropper, eh?
No!
Now do it if you can. When you hear the thunder under your head...
Oh!
...and see the lights dancing in your eyes...
No!
...and feel the iron wheels a foot from your neck...
No!
...remember! Bite!
Oh! Heavens! He's going to be murdered before my very eyes! How can I aid him?
Who's that? I do, but I thought that it was an angel's and that I was dead. Where are you?
Well, I'm in the station.
Well, I can't see you, but I can hear you. Now listen to me, miss, for I've only a few minutes to live.
Oh, and I cannot aid you.
Never mind about me, miss. I might as well die here and now as at any other time. Do you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Is there nothing in there? No crowbar, no hammer?
There's nothing in here.
Oh!
Oh, the train!
Gentlemen, in this confusion, we introduce a temporary conclusion. You want to know what happened? Have no fear. She pulled the lever, switched the points, and here the couple stand in mutual affection while the train thunders off in that direction.
Don't you think, though, that the actors and the actresses put it over very well?
Oh,
I think that the personality came out. Definitely.
I think a good majority of the people that went over to see... when we went to see this play,
thought, oh,
honestly,
no.
We'll go as it's somewhere to go. It'd be dull, but it's somewhere to go. And I wouldn't mind betting that all of them that come out there
enjoyed this.
Come out with a different frame of mind that they went in with.
I thoroughly enjoyed it. It really gripped me.
Of course, the better the show, the more likely you are to gather an audience, I think. But I do not believe that any artistic medium should lower its standards in order to attract its audience. I think that's totally the wrong way of going about it.
I'd like to know why you chose predominantly comedy. Were you afraid of ideas? Were you afraid of words that people wouldn't understand? You chose snippets from classical plays that were meant to entertain us. The movement entertained us. But why not some idea, something that would move us?
Trouble is that when you have excerpts, it's like when you go to the pictures and you see the excerpts of the next week.
They look good.
They look good, and then they're either disappointed.
But that's what I'm saying.
They show you a good piece. Yes. And then it's like a series on television. It's just getting interesting, and then it's to be continued next week.
Yeah.
You've got to see all of something to appreciate it.
I think television is helping the theatre. I think it's ruining the cinema, and about time too. I think the public is better informed because of television. more aware. The Wars of the Roses that we did reached millions of people on television, more than those plays have played to in their entire history since Shakespeare wrote them. This must drive at least 2 or 3% of those millions into the theatre.
Yeah, but that's the whole point. So you, why do you sit indoors when not going, you can go and sit indoors?
Well, there you are. You've got it put in front of you. You're sure of having a good view.
Surely, but you would get in the theatre.
If they had a company like you had, and was to say have an agreement that you could use the school once every month or 3 months, you know,
yes,
sort of tour around,
oh, yes,
you'd get lots of people because you think, oh, they're coming in 3 months' time, I should remember that date in the diary, you know, and you'd make a point of going.
Yeah, but then you can't expect these people to put these things in your lap without making an effort to go to where they're performing.
No, I think they'd have lots more people, though.
The theatre does provide something which no other media provides. If we could stop it feeling old-fashioned, intellectual, pretentious, highbrow, and middle class and over 50, I think we could surprise a tremendous number of people.
And 3 minutes from The Birthday Party by Harold Pinter.
Take off his glasses. Weber, you're a fake. When did you last wash up a cup?
Christmas before last.
Where?
Lion's Corner House.
Which one?
Marble Arch.
Where was your wife?
In.
Answer.
What wife?
What have you done with your wife?
He's killed his wife.
Why did you kill your wife?
What wife? How did he kill her?
How did you kill her?
You throttled her.
With arsenic.
There's your man.
Where's your mum?
In the sanatorium. Yes.
Weber, why did you never get married?
She was waiting at the porch.
You skedaddled from the wedding.
He left her in the lurch.
You left her in the pudding club.
She was waiting at the church.
Weber! Why did you change your name?
I forgot the other one.
What's your name now?
Joseph.
You stink of sin!
I can smell it.
Do you recognise an external force?
What?
Do you recognise an external force?
That's the question.
Do you recognise an external force responsible for you, suffering for you?
It's late.
Late, late enough. When did you last pray?
He's sweating.
When did you last pray?
He's sweating.
Is the number 846 possible or necessary?
Neither.
Wrong. Is the number 846 possible or necessary?
Both.
Wrong. It is necessary but not possible.
Both.
Wrong. Why do you think the number 846 is necessarily possible?
Must be.
Wrong. It is only necessarily necessary. We admit possibility only after we grant necessity. It is possible because necessary, but by no means necessary through possibility. The possibility can only be assumed after the proof of necessity.
Right.
Right. Of course, right. We're right, and you're wrong, Weber, all along the line.
All along the line.
Where is your lecturer leading you?
You'll pay for this.
You stuff yourself with dry toast.
You contaminate womankind.
Why don't you pay the rent?
Mother Defiler.
Why do you pick your nose?
I demand justice.
What's your trade?
What about Ireland?
What's your trade?
I play the piano.
How many fingers do you use?
No hands.
No society would touch you, not even a building society.
You're a traitor to the cloth.
What are you for pyjamas?
Nothing.
You verminate the sheet of your birth.
What about the Albert Jensenist heresy?
Who watered the wicked in Melbourne?
What about the blessed Oliver Plunkett?
Speak up! Weber, why did the chicken cross the road?
He wanted to. He doesn't know.
Why did the chicken cross the road?
He wanted.
Why did the chicken cross the road?
He wanted. He doesn't know. He doesn't know which came first.
Which came first?
Chicken, egg. Which came first?
He doesn't know.